Well, now Beryl Bainbridge completes her examination of the differences between North and South with a look at the Powells of Bentley in Forever England.
It's ladies' night at the Haberdasher's Hall in the City of London, and the banquet is about to begin. 40 years ago, if you lived in the north and you told anyone that you were going down south, they'd have known you meant London. The north stretched from Birmingham to Newcastle and then became Scotland. Devon and Cornwall were seaside resorts. Surrey and Somerset and Suffolk and all the rest of those distant counties were simply places to which you went on holiday. The real and only down south was London, that feast of history, that piratical heart of England. The worshipful company of haberdashers was established in the reign of Henry VI, when it founded a school for the education of the poor. Today it is the manager and trustee of 8 scholastic institutions, the administrator of over 100 charities, and the benefactor of 18 ecclesiastical livings.
Postmaster and Mrs. Patrick Cole.
Good evening,
very successful to you. Very, very good. Yeah.
Thank you very much indeed.
Christine and Patrick Pole live in the home county of Hampshire, in the village of Bentley, on the ancient road from Southampton to London. It has a medieval church, a village pond, a few splendid old houses, all set in a rolling landscape once covered by forest. Their house is planted in a perfect English garden.
Where did you meet Patrick?
I met him in London at a house of mutual friends, actually, at a dance, pre-war, along 1937 or 8, I think.
Was he at Cambridge then, or working?
No, he was working then, yes, yes. And I was at
you
King's.
You were at King's.
Yes. Great fun.
But you were given a very good education, didn't you?
I had a marvellous education, yes, I did. And I thoroughly enjoyed school, too. Contrary to a lot of people, I really loved it. But then I was a hockey-playing miss, I suppose, really. Which was something that you didn't look down upon in those days, perhaps. But I enjoyed it all. I loved it. I think the only thing I didn't enjoy was the war. Hated that. Mm. Then everybody did, didn't they? Mm. It was a ghastly experience, and I was very, very lucky to have a husband at the end of it too, because practically everybody died off in his squadron, was killed in his squadron. So I was extremely lucky to have him back again. I hope they'll survive till next summer.
And did you know the moment you saw her?
Oh, yeah.
Did you really, though?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, she gets so bored of this story.
Well,
I don't know whether
I
dare tell it to you. She gets so bored of it. Well, she won't like me telling her this at all. I went out to dinner in London to a friend's house. It was a dinner party before going to the old Sherborne girls' annual dance for their mission that they helped to run, or they were involved in. And I went out to dinner with these people, and I was standing by the fireplace talking to my hostess. In she came with her male escort. I saw her, she came in, I turned to my hostess and said, "Who's that girl? Because I shall marry her." Like that.
It's such a romantic thing to do.
Well, it was rather. Mm. But then I wasn't very good at that sort of thing. I wasn't a share one's feelings very much.
Is that because of schooling and background?
Well, that's what they say.
It doesn't seem to have done anybody any harm, though.
Well, she's anti, and of course Lizzie is anti children going to boarding school at an early age. And I don't know what will happen to Lulu, but it's I don't know. I think they've got a point. Obviously, with some children, they would be absolutely right. But with other children, somehow they need to get away from their mother's apron strings and go and get a bit of male discipline. That's my reaction to it all. And I found that with both Bruce and Martin, they did them good to get a bit of discipline and mix with other children. Learn to mix with other children.
Did you enjoy your school?
Oh, loved it, yes.
Loved it.
I was a natural. And so were Bruce and Martin. They were naturals. But some people hate it, of course.
Yeah.
Loathe it. But I was a natural. They were naturals.
Did the children have ponies when they were the little? Did you have
them? No, they weren't that way. It was always the ball game.
Mm.
Anything to do with a bat and a ball or a racket. But they weren't really interested in horses.
To the layman, this game of Eton Fives seems to consist of nothing more elaborate than the slamming of a ball against a wall. And that's precisely how it began a century ago, when the boys of Eton School bounced a ball against the buttress side of the chapel. Bruce and Martin Pole are playing in the court at Ludgrove Preparatory School near Wokingham, where little boys in beautiful surroundings are coached at some expense for the first important fixture of their lives, the entrance exam to the public schools.
When you were at school, did you know what you wanted to do?
No, I didn't know at all. Not at all. And I was very welcome of, very pleased to have the opportunity to not have to make my mind up immediately after I left school. I had a year between school and university during which I travelled quite widely. I worked my passage on a boat to Australia, taught in Australia.
What is it? You went as a sailor?
I went as a
cabin
supernumerary deck apprentice, or dog's body as I was more politely referred to as. And I worked my passage on board. It was in fact a cargo ship which had a small number of passengers on board. And my main responsibility was to look after the 12 dogs that also came along with us.
I shouldn't imagine there were many public school boys on board, though.
No, there weren't. I certainly had a number of my sharp edges rubbed off during that trip. In fact, it was very difficult making friends with people who were, you know, very far removed from the sort of place I'd just come from.
You've got three girls and a boy. How are you going to educate them?
We haven't made any
definite
decisions yet,
yes.
But certainly the girls, we see no reason at all for the girls to have the kind of education that indeed Lizzie had, which was a boarding school education, because there are lots of very good schools round within daily commuting distance of where we live. Lots of good schools of all kinds, and the choice is very wide.
Isn't there the same choice for Louis?
There is the same choice for Louis. I went to boarding school, and I can point you to the statistics which would indicate that that particular school is one of the most successful in terms of academic results and achievement. I was very happy at that school, and my father was very happy there, my brother was happy there as well. It is, if you look at the statistics, one of the best schools in the country. If it's a boarding school, a private boarding school, it's not a state school. If we can afford to send him, why not send him to the place where we know there is a very good education to be had?
That place, as Bruce puts it, is Eton, where he and Martin went, and Patrick before them. One night a week, Bruce stays up in London at the flat of a friend. He's an accountant with a publishing firm of Octopus. The rest of the time, he commutes from Long Sutton, a village 4 miles from Bentley. His wife Lizzie, at home with the children, misses him and regrets that his work leaves him so little time for the family.
I mean, the thing is, I married him before I'd got all these theories out. And it's not fair that I should suddenly turn around and expect him to change his whole life. But I might, after 20 years, I might suddenly say, look, you've got to share your life more with me. Or share it with the children, what's left of the children, you know, wherever they are.
Would he do that, do you think?
Yes, he will, after, he will when he's about 50, I think. But until then, I couldn't possibly. I mean, I have pride. I've asked him, you know. I said, please, you know, why don't you stay at home? And he says, I would get no fulfillment out of it. I wouldn't be able to do it. And I just, you know, just not me. I don't want my girls to go to boarding school unless they insist that that's what they think is right. I'd like them to go to a good day school and have everything that I can give them in terms of education within that, you know, within the not going away. If when they're 14 or 15 or 16, they suddenly say, Mummy, I want to go to boarding school, then I'll certainly say, yes, they'd want to. But I don't think boarding school does girls any good at all.
But you'd send Louis?
I send Louis because Bruce is away for 12 hours a day at least. And I watch quite a lot of my friends who have boys of 12, 13, 14. They become very difficult. They don't particularly want to be with their mothers all the time, or with three older girls. They actually want to be with boys. And I don't want to get into a stage where Louis's fighting with me all the time and I'm always slamming him and sort of saying, where's your other son? I don't know. I mean, we, in our family, we have so much. And we're terribly, incredibly privileged, I think.
When you say you're incredibly privileged, I mean, what, because you're happy? Because of money?
We're happily married. I've got 4 smashing children. And we've got a nice house in the country. We don't have money nightmares. And, I mean, I'm sort of basically an unhappy person who's happy. It's the housewife bit, I think, that really makes you feel that. Because you go out time and time again, you go out to dinner and you go and talk to people. And they say, what do you do? And you say, well, you know, I've got 4 children, I look after them. Mm. Everybody says, oh, well, really, you know, how interesting. And they turn to the next door neighbour and then discuss real things like money and politics and
Would
jobs.
You have liked to have been something else if you weren't that?
That's a good question. I really want to be a good mother to my children.
The Pole children are fortunate to go to such a pleasant school in such rural surroundings. But it's the only one in the area that isn't threatened with closure.
Without any word, we had this morning. It was, you remember that very well, you nearly got it. Here's another new word we had this morning. What does it begin with?
Rosie, Martin Pole's wife, was educated at grammar school in Derry and at Aberystwyth University. I went on a picnic with her and her little son Jesse and her friend Jean. We toiled up a mountain, a well-known beauty spot, though Rosie insisted it was only a hill.
Are there naughty men in this wood?
I hope not.
I would have thought it was quite a dangerous place to go
yes.
walks in.
Well, there's never been any cases of you know, problems with.
You did never consider a nanny?
Oh, no, no. I think that I ought to be with my child. And really, I'd probably go to work to buy labour-saving machines which enable me to go to work. It goes round and round.
Yeah.
You know.
Why do you think you ought to be with your child? I mean, were you brought up to think that, or is it just you?
I wouldn't expect all mothers to stay at home. Yeah. It's a personal decision.
But it is an enormous change if you have
been Oh, absolutely, yes.
Because we're never taught things like patience and
no,
this total
wired,
commitment.
Isn't it?
It's a good job the hormones take over and make you able to. Though, because in some cases they don't, do they?
Some people just simply can't cope and end up resenting their families. That's the sort of supermarket slapping syndrome which I absolutely hate. I would have no hesitation to go up to someone and say, do you have to smack that child? A bit like if you see a dog being stumped or something.
Mm. Will you send him away to school?
Perhaps, if I thought he would benefit from it. I wouldn't send him away just for the sake of it. The whole week.
That's that way Amy's looking up at you so beautifully, isn't she?
Oh, my looking
Now he's cheerful.
You're gurgling. You're a mutt.
That's Martin Powell on his kamikaze ride to his office in Holborn. He left home at 7 o'clock this morning to board the train to Waterloo. Like Bruce, he too is an accountant.
85% or 90% of three.
Going to be dipping in November and then breaking even in December. So.
And at the end of the day, when the rush hour starts, there's the journey back to be faced again. And Byfleet, Woking and Aldershot, to the dark ride home and the evening half gone. He and Rosie recently moved to a house just down the road from his parents. They didn't plan to live so near, but the house came onto the market and it was too good an opportunity to miss. He's already given a lot of thought to Jesse's future, though he's not blindly following a pattern and is keeping an open mind.
We've got to make decisions. And that's really concentrated mine more than anything
You mean else. Financially, do you mean, or...?
No, more the type of education that we envisage. We can afford one child's education anyway. But one's heard all sorts of terrifying stories of a girl being treated different to boys and that sort of thing, and we don't want to have double standards in this.
Did you ever think of doing anything but business, going into business?
Not really, no. When I first went to university, I went in order to get an interpreting degree. But when I actually got there, I discovered that the people who actually go on and get the interpreting degree are highly intelligent, very extrovert, vocal people. Who are very good at ad-libbing, and
when you say that, you make it sound as if you don't think that highly of yourself. That
I've always had to struggle with exams and things. It's always been hard work for me. Mm-hmm. You win some, you lose some, but it's obviously Bruce has never had any trouble with exams and that sort of thing, and it's much easier for him.
You're shy, but you're not. You're not all that shy, are you? Not really shy.
If people let me talk, then I will talk, but I'm not always allowed to have my head. So many talkers in our family that one can't always manage to get on the same. With father with a loud stock exchange voice, and Bruce, who is always talking a tremendous amount, sometimes difficult to get a word in.
Baden Powell, no relation to the Poles, once lived in the village of Bentley, and it was he who was responsible for the extraordinary monument next door to the bus stop.
I've had a word with Mrs. Caddick, who lives just down the road here. She's a wood carver. She's going to look.
Patrick is in charge of restoring it to its former, if incongruous, glory.
So we can make this a village affair. Mrs. Caddick doing the woodwork, if she'd be so that's kind, right. And Richard doing the repair work. That's smart.
Patrick thinks that Christine is more caring than he is, and believes that her politics are left of centre.
You like stealing, yes. I like
Bruce told me that he thought his mother was a frustrated free thinker.
I'm very fond of stew. Somebody said, what do you live off at home? And I said, stews.
She qualified as a dietitian at King's College. And it's come in handy. There's a tradition among landed country folk of service to the community. And both Patrick and Christine believe that if you're fortunate enough to be privileged, you owe something in return.
If the opportunity is there, you've got to take it, I think.
But most people would say, you see, that certainly not at this stage in your lives, but earlier, that everybody's excuse is they're far too busy to do anything, mm-hmm. or they'd wish they could join in that, but they've got too much to do. And mm-hmm. it seems to me you transcended all that and actually actively believed that mm-hmm. you should participate.
Always fine. I agree. Young mothers and things like that, and husbands building up their business. They are busy, but there's always something you can do. Mm.
And did you always live here a sort of a village life? I mean, did you always join in immediately you got here?
Oh, yes.
Yes. Well, I've always been accustomed to living in a village, you see, with all the things that go on, you know, the OWI and all the funny old things that happen in the village. And you're part of a community, and I think if you live in a village, you should try and contribute to that community. On the whole, people do quite a lot in the village.
The cricket and the football and things like that.
You used to run all those things.
Centre. I was a commuter to London. I used to go up every day. But I tried to play my part during the rest of the time.
When we came, there were 6 people who used to commute from Bentley. Now I think there are 56. Mm. There's a car park there, which there never used to be. The whole thing is escalated.
And it's full, too.
Yes, it is.
Patrick's working life was spent in the city. In Cambridge, he joined his father's stockbroking firm and became a blue button, running messages on the floor of the stock exchange before becoming a dealer himself. Patrick thinks that everything has changed, become too big. But then that's inevitable, now that it's all international. It amazes him, really, all this talk of jobbers and brokers and dual capacity being the great thing to aim for. And yet Lloyd's are doing the exact opposite. It all went over my head. lunch to meet his cousin John, his one-time partner and an assistant deputy chairman of the Stock Exchange.
Gold, Australians, diamonds. Your father dealt in diamonds, yeah. mine dealt in gold shares, and mother dealt in the American shares. So they're all traders. They weren't really what we know as stockbrokers now.
We've just been up north, and when you come down to the south, I mean, all the power and business are all down here. It's no wonder the north feels a bit cut off. Everything's up here, isn't it?
Well, the stock market is down here.
And the Bank of England.
I mean, there actually were stock exchanges all through the country. And I was actually on the original committee which merged all the stock exchanges into one. But that was their wish. They wanted to come into the bigger market.
But you see, one of the big problems between North and South is if you take the original development of our industries. Coal was the basic fuel, wasn't it? Now, around coal developed all the basic industries, steel, shipbuilding, railways, etc., etc. But now, that has changed. Down south, much more service industries, finance, and added to that, EEC. And the geographical position of the South, the Southeast especially, must mean that the attraction is down to the South and away from the North.
It's competition. Life is competitive.
And I reckon no matter how much the government of the day tries to replace what has moved away with other substitutes, it's almost impossible to go more than a certain distance because the facilities have got to be there. And there you have the skilled labour lying dormant, and this is where the training schemes have got to be further developed in order to give the next generation a different skill to the previous generation.
The trouble is, once the skills have been taught, there still aren't enough jobs to go around, north or south. And the reality is that once that baffling market of stocks and shares, futures and commodities, gold and diamonds has been left behind, the majority live their lives at the mercy of the fluctuating fortunes of world trade and world recession. Bruce, because of his education and his background, is one of the lucky ones, and he appreciates it.
Can you imagine that your life would have been utterly different had you been up north, lived up north, for instance? I mean, when you were at school, were there many people that went to the school from northern cities?
At school, you met an awful lot of people who came from non-south.
But one could almost say that perhaps it's nothing to do with where you're born. Perhaps it's a class thing, the difference between the north and south.
Yeah. Well, I think the north, and indeed the south, have the full range of what in advertising circles they call the A to D or E or whatever it is, the full range of the moneyed and the less moneyed, less fortunate people. I have never lived in the north, so I don't really know enough people from the north to draw any real judgment as to what's going on up there. And my attitude does tend to be on the statistics and common sense on the one hand, and also what I'm told by the media and television on the other. And that certainly paints a very gloomy picture of the north, which I don't always find supported when I meet people who do actually live up there. I think the sort of statistics that really do make people, if I was in the north, make me absolutely cringe is when you take the same house, i.e. a three-bedroom, semi-detached, terraced house in a town, and you say that the price for that is 21,000 on average in parts of the north and going down, and the price for the same house is 38,000 and going up in the south. Mm. I mean, in terms of privilege, the family was able to give me enough money to be able to own my own house. I first owned a flat in London, a small couple of bedrooms flat in London when I was working in London as an accountant. And to have the rung, the first step on the housing ladder these days is absolutely critical. If you don't have enough money, if you're not lucky enough to have enough money to get started, I don't see these days how anyone ever does get started at all when you look at the prices, especially in the South, that are being charged for houses, which are absolutely unbelievable in terms of what people's earning capacity is.
Says that in his experience, old age comes naturally and gradually, and that he doesn't mind being old, just so long as Christine is there. Grandchildren came to stay while Lizzie and Bruce were abroad. Young children are exhausting, but the garden and its pond are an extension of the house, and Yolanda was there to help.
Wish you'd have that tap mended.
That gets on your nerves, doesn't it?
It drives me balmy.
The only thing to do is to put it onto a cloth or something, because no plumber can mend it.
Yolanda, Mrs. Beckhurst, joined the Powell household when she was 15 years old.
Not even Eddie.
So these are all bulbs under here, you see. It's a... You've got to be very careful not to uproot them. That's why you can't dig them over. Now, I've uprooted one there, I can't be helped. You try and spend, if our activities allow us, about 3 or 4 hours a day in our garden. Ah. Now, that's either a phone call or a cup of tea.
We were waiting for the children to come to tea, and we got to talking about families, all our families, about marriage and divorce, and mums without husbands, and children without fathers.
I personally think that children are not thought about as important enough now, so therefore I think they need the security that a marriage, proper marriage, gives them. I think it's all very well to feel free, and it's very nice for the parents to be able to push off if they feel like it. They got found somebody else, but I think it, the children, I'd be sad for my grandchildren, and I worry about the generation on the up, the little smalls. No, they'll probably adjust. I think it's hard for them there. I'm more for trying to keep the background secure so that they know that whenever they deviate, whenever they do fanciful things, and they all fly away, and if you're lucky they come back again, they must do this, they must find their feet. But they need also something at the back to come back to with certain standards that they can go over, but they know they're there. And I think they're the most sort of settled and happy people on the whole that one meets. The ones that aren't happy are usually the ones that drift and roam, and they're one that they come first with, really, is what it boils down to, I think. Are they on their way? The others, I wonder. Are you well?
Nice to present again.
Hello.
Hello, Emil.
Lovely letter you sent. Thank you very much for that lovely letter.
Jess is here.
Is he?
Yes. Somewhere. Yeah. I don't know quite where. Martin was going to pick the apples up the big bramlet.
Yeah.
Over there. What are you doing?
A precarious job.
Martin! Granny will help him. Sit right on the end. That's it. That's it. Whoa!
Oh, Harry.
Whoa!
Jemima, do it gently.
I can't!
Make it gentle.
Can you do it to the other end? Yeah, no, I think Jemima better go in the middle, and then Harry, don't you? That's it. Millie, you go that end.
Take Millie on that end. Millie and Harry should be doing
it. Better come
in the middle,
yes.
Harry.
Actually, if you bust them in the middle,
they'll do better.
Why do we do?
You
need your habit.
Let's try.
I'm at the end of my journey. My attempt to discover if there is a real division between the north and the south of England.
Hello, Jim. All the way up and all the way down.
I was biased from the start, quite apart from industrial and historical considerations, seeing that I was born in Liverpool. But what I hadn't realised is that this geographical demarcation is as nothing compared to the barriers which now exist between rich and poor, educated and ignorant, black and white, the old and the young. Never before has a generation been faced with extinction. If that doesn't change things, nothing will.
There's the 9 o'clock news over on BBC One now with Julia Somerville and John Humphreys.
Every Thursday, right throughout the summer, I'll be bringing you live The Travel Show with all the latest news and information on this summer's holiday scene.
And I'll be out in the sun. Each week I'll be reporting from a different resort. We start in Rhodes, then Mallorca, Lido di Jesolo in Italy, Brittany, Lorette on the Costa Brava, and then Lucerne in Switzerland. And that's only the first half.
And I'll be able to tell you what you're in for. Will it be a worse summer than last year, or are we in for a real scorcher?
And we'll be looking at British holidays. Each week a different family tells us how their holiday's going and what it's costing.
Join Paul Heine, Kathy Rochford and Jim Bacon tomorrow in The Travel Show, live at 9 o'clock on BBC Two.